Watch this. Whoa! That was stupid. Why did I do that? Hey guys, I'm gonna be doing an unboxing after this Q&A, so don't click away afterwards. I want to share this experience with you all, something that'll be very special to me. It's not music related, but it's still kind of cool. It's kind of a neat story behind it. So anyway, first, the Q&A. We had a lot of questions this time. This is pretty cool. So we'll go ahead and start off with Adam. He says, at what age did you start playing the guitar, and would you do a tutorial on Stairway to Heaven? It would mean very much if you could. Well, I'm probably not the guy to do the Stairway to Heaven tutorial. Probably not even be able to do that justice, and I'm sure there's many other tutorials on YouTube that people are already doing that very well. But to answer your first question, though, what age did I start playing guitar? I was 17 years old at the time. I had just turned 17. It was just on a whim one night after church. I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to go home and learn some chords. After watching a YouTube video over and over of a guy playing guitar, I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna do that. I want to be a rock star like him. Second question is from Shredder. Do you gent? Well, let me just say, I have a But Does It Gent shirt on from Jared Dine's channel, so I definitely gent. Matthew asks, hi Brandon, I'm wondering how you progress to be able to play fast. I'm struggling with practicing this as I feel I overcomplicate it. Okay, so I'm not sure exactly what you meant on your question. I didn't know if you mean how did I progress so quickly, or I guess maybe you're asking how did I be able to actually play fast as opposed to playing slow on the guitar. Either way, the answer is the same. The progression all comes from practicing, and as you said, you know, you feel like you're overcomplicating it. I'll just tell you what I did. I didn't really have a practice routine. When I started guitar, I started because of Canon Rock. That video Fun 2 did that day that I decided to pick up the guitar, I knew it had to start with some chords, so I started with some chords. Kept learning my chords over and over until I had the, you know, chords down, or at least I thought I did. And it wasn't but maybe a month afterwards of having the, you know, starting on the acoustic guitar, I moved to the electric, and I just, you know, grew from there, taught myself songs, you know, by ear, things that I wanted to play, downloaded tablature from ultimateguitar.com. Learned from a lot of people on YouTube, and eventually started a membership. Well, I'm no longer a member now. I was a member at guitarmasterclass.net, learning a lot of those lessons and just taking techniques from songs. So I would actually learn not an entire song, but just maybe a piece of the song, and try to have a takeaway. Hey, how can I use this in context of a song? Whenever you have the time to practice, whether you're asking how do you progress so quickly, or how do you learn to play fast as opposed to playing slow, you have to start slow, and you just practice with a metronome or what have you, you know, backing track, and then just go and go until you get faster and faster. You have to start slow, have to start somewhere. My whole journey of guitar was very jumbled and very trial and error-ish. All right, made up a new word. All right, so Frederick asks, for how long have you been playing guitar and what inspired you to start? Okay, that's funny. I just answered that question a moment ago. I've been playing guitar for about 8 years. So, Frederick, if you haven't seen that video, go check out my 8 years reflection video. It's kind of a throwback to my experience. And what inspired me to start was Fun 2's video, Canon Rock. And he also asked, if you could go back in time and tell yourself one thing when you started playing, what would you say? After thinking a moment, I think I know what I would tell myself, and I believe I would tell myself, Brandon, learn more music theory now when you have the thirst for knowledge. When I first started guitar, I was really, really hungry for guitar knowledge of any sorts. Now that I am to the point where I've kind of plateaued, and I don't feel like the learning curve as much as I have. Now, of course, not that I know everything about guitar, my goodness, but it's just that you get to that point in your guitar journey that you're like, okay, I'm good. And you kind of get lazy is what I'm trying to say. I would say, hey, learn more music theory now, because it'll be a whole lot easier for you to do composing. You'll be a better writer. You'll be a better guitarist overall. And your first EP with your band will sound a whole lot better too. Next question, Christian asks, how do you go about writing new songs? I'm actually working on a song now Not my Christmas single. That's a different project, but this is would be something, an independent single that I'm working on now. It usually has to do with an event that has happened in my life, or a series of events or experiences that inspire me to start the song in the first place. So it usually starts with the subject, if it's going to be a song with lyrics, that is. If it's not, if it's just instrumental, then it's usually just inspiration from a player or something. So how I usually start tracks, it's usually I start with the chorus, because it just feels so much easier when I have the chorus done. I feel like that's the core of the song. That's the part that usually everybody remembers and everybody sings. I actually did a video on how I write music. If you all want to check that out, it's a little bit more of an older video, but it still applies. So the song that I'm working on is called Breaking Point, and it speaks about a point in my life where I was almost to my breaking point, but then instead of it being a linear song where it just stays that way, it's going to be a song that talks about the hope that you can be brought out of that. So that's how I start with writing new songs, is I just start with an idea, inspiration, and I evolve that into how do I want the end of the song to make you feel like. All right, next question. Weston asks, if you could have any guitar and amp for free, what guitar and amp would you pick? A Skirvison Raptor 8-string version with fanned frets, maybe a natural wood finish. As far as the amplifier, would a Kemper profiling amp work? Probably not, because it's not really an amp, it's a profiler. I guess if it had to be an actual amp, it would probably be the 5150 amp, because I just love the way that sounds. So that's probably what I would pick. Next question is from Ron. He says, what brand of guitar do you usually use? And I would say that would be Ibanez, because that's what I started with, and I've had more Ibanez-made guitars than any other. That's just something that I've been used to, and I really love how thin the necks are. I don't really like the big chunky necks. I like that thin feel. It's just easier to play on and everything, so Ibanez. And I also like the way they sound, too. And I would say that I prefer the soloist type, you know, the soloist body style, like all my guitars look like. That's just my preference. So that's another side note. I won't charge you for that one. All right, next to last question, and I don't even think I'm going to pronounce this correctly at all, but Folang, whatever, I don't know how to say it, but he asks, do you regret not learning sweep picking from the beginning? Yeah, I do regret not learning it from the beginning, and that kind of goes back to how I would go back in time if I could and tell myself, hey, learn theory, and probably also, hey, learn sweep picking also. That will really help you too, you know. But I mean, it's okay. I mean, there's a whole lot of players out there that do not sweep pick. I would consider myself a rhythm player primarily instead of a soloist player, just because that's my strength. And I still could. It's not too late. I always tell people that, you know, you're never too late to start learning something. So maybe one day I will pick that up again and, you know, try to learn sweep picking. All right, and the very last question is from Game Jab, and this is the gaming channel that I wrote music for and I've posted videos on. They ask, what is the most overused effect you use when mixing and composing? That is very easy. I easily overuse reverb. I love what reverb adds, and sometimes it can be very complimentary to a mix, but when you add too much to it, everything gets, you know, washed out, and it's really hard to distinguish things. Sometimes I will have reverb all over the place in my mix, and I'm turning up volumes, compressing everything, and just squashing everything, and I'll listen back in the car, and I'm like, man, this sounds horrible. Why? And then I'll just turn down some reverb stuff, rebalance some, you know, volume levels, and I'm like, oh, sounds better now. That is the Q&A, and now I want to unbox this box. I have been waiting for so long, and now I get to finally unbox it, and you get to experience it with me. Okay, and I'm going to put on my glasses because I actually wear glasses on a regular basis, and I want to be able to see this. As I am opening this, I did go see Rogue One with my dad and my brother. No spoilers, but it was a good movie, but it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. I will say that. It's not as good as The Force Awakens, in my opinion, but it was still a good movie. If you haven't seen it and you like Star Wars, go check it out. It's probably going to be just one of those movies that grows on me. So anyway, this is from Clearly Canadian.
They are a company that I don't know a whole lot about them. They used to be around a long time ago, and they're just starting their services back up. They're flavored water, basically. So they're trying to start their product back up. And so this was part of like a Kickstarter, if you will. I ordered the Mountain Blackberry because Rhett and Link recommended it. They talked about it, and it was Link's favorite flavor. And so that's what I chose. So anyway, this will be my actual unboxing experience. And what this is what's cool is it says it's all natural, non-GMO, vegan, whatever. No preservatives added and stuff, which is important to me because my body can't really deal with all that artificial stuff. I get sick after a while, so I have to be careful with what I eat and drink and things. So hopefully this will be okay, and I think it shall. So, and here it is. It's 18-pound box, it said on the outside. I hope this tastes good, too. I mean, after all, I bought a whole pack of them, too. Okay, here we are. So yeah, if you haven't checked out Clearly Canadian before, I promise this ain't sponsored. This is literally, I bought this with my own money. I don't know, maybe over a year ago? I can't remember. It's been a long time in the making, and they finally were able to start bringing back their product and things. And like I said, I don't know a whole lot about it. I just jumped on the bandwagon because it was for Rhett and Link and stuff. They you know, were talking about it, and we're supposed to get like a studio tour from Rhett and Link. I can smell it. I really can. Sparkling water beverage, all natural ingredients. Probably can't really see that very well because it's clear and everything, but that's it right there. So anyway, I'm gonna go ahead and open this up and enjoy it right here. Let's see, I don't know. Oh, here it goes. So it's carbonated a bit. Whoa, oh, okay, it's bubbling, but it's not gonna overflow. For a second, I thought it was about to overflow. All right, so the moment of truth. Hopefully it's well worth it. If not, I guess I can always give it to family or somebody. Whoa, it's like soda. It does taste good, I think. Yeah, it's different. Let me see. It's carbonated, so yeah, not too bad. I guess time will tell whether my body will accept this, you know, and you know, I usually know when something is not natural because if I drink a beverage that's not natural, usually my throat burns after a while. But it says carbonated spring water, pure cane sugar, natural flavoring, citric acid, spring water sources. And then it says where the sources are from. Clearly Canadian, you know, from Ontario, Canada. So I, like I said, I know. Wow. So anyway, like I said, I know this is not music related and only probably a few of you stuck around for this. But, you know, I just wanted to share this with you, and I think it's pretty good taste. I mean, there were like, what, how many other flavors to choose from? There was going to be wild cherry, country raspberry, and orchard peach. Probably, I'd probably enjoy orchard peach also. That's why I have these Wednesday videos with you guys, because I wanted to share things with things that are going on in my life. So far, I'm good, so I don't feel bad like after I drink an actual soda, like a Coca-Cola or Dr. Pepper or something like that. I feel okay, so I guarantee you it's not any better than kombucha, though. I think that was all that I wanted to say. I guess I'll take off my glasses again so you can see my eyes, the crazy glare. I will see you next Wednesday. I don't know what we'll talk about next Wednesday. If we have more questions, maybe we'll do another Q&A. You know where to post them. Comments below. So I will see you guys this Saturday. Take care. Yeah, yeah. Oh, I just thought of something. Well, it's too late now. It's already been like, do this. I just shook it up. Watch this. Whoa! That was stupid. Why did I do that? Why did I do that? This is what happens when you film a video when you have woken up not too long ago. It's a bit sticky. I gotta get a sponge to clean this up.